Now, I've travelled all the way to America to a place called Portland in the state of Maine, and I'm going to meet and interview Peter Hyatt. Peter Hyatt is an expert on statement analysis, and he actually gives lectures and teaches people how to analyse witness statements. And we're going to be discussing the Madeleine McCann case.
Today I am joined by Peter Hyatt, whose expertise is in statement analysis. Peter, can you just tell us, how did you become interested in statement analysis?
Quite a number of years ago, I was self-described naive, very easy to deceive person. So I began reading books on statement analysis just as a hobby. Mm-hmm. But eventually, this led into an employment where I was given an initial 200 hours of training back in late 2001, I believe, in legally sound interviewing. And from there, I went into more formal training, worked on cases as a state investigator for allegations of child abuse and later on allegations of adult abuse. But then I went to teaching statement analysis, and after teaching it, it was very natural that those who attended would ask for assistance. And sometimes that assistance translated into, would you do the investigation for us, especially in private companies. From there, I became more and more involved with law enforcement, in training law enforcement, assisting law enforcement. And so currently I work full-time as an analyst and an instructor, teaching law enforcement, teaching journalists, lawyers, therapists, all different professionals who study the techniques used to discern deception, but also content analysis. So it goes well beyond just saying if someone is lying or not. What are they lying about? Why are they lying? Mm-hmm. Which leads to the ultimate is when someone sends an anonymous threatening letter, statement analysis is often able to identify who wrote this letter and what the person that wrote the letter is like. Right. This allows them to know, is this threat real? The training involves testing, quizzes, practice, more tests, more quiz, more practice. Eventually, we offer a certification, and this is also part of the University of Maine's continuing education units, we call it CEUs, for professional licenses. Mm-hmm. So people are involved in formal training are able to reach a level of certification. The certification is only worth what the work shows it to be. And in many detecting deception schools, they run around 70% success. For us, that's would be an abysmal result. These investigators are running at or near 100% success rate.
Right. And you can test that by you make an assertion during the investigation stage based on their statements, and then if someone is then convicted on other evidence, you know that you were correct. So that gives you a way of measuring the performance, yeah?
That's one way of measuring. This is actually rather exciting. There's an easier way to measure the success is the confession.
Yeah.
The confession or admission, and we have that more than convictions. Because when a person is deceptive, and during the interview process, where they are confronted using their own words, it is legally sound, it is non-interpretive, but where they're confronted with their own words, they often will either confess or admit what they have done. Now, the difference between a confession and admission is, legally, we need one or the other, but an admission is to acknowledge what one has done. A confession would say, what I've done is this, plus it's morally wrong. We don't need a confession, we do need an admission. Mm-hmm. Then we have something, it's called the A to Z. This is very exciting. An A to Z is where an investigator, say in law enforcement, receives a report of an allegation. Someone has stolen. And before any of the interviews or any of the investigation begins, the person who is accused of stealing is told to write out what happened. They are to sit down comfortably, choose their own words, they're given bottled water, in a comfortable setting. There is no threats, there is no coercion. Please tell us in your own words what happened. The person says, well, where do I begin? Wherever you feel comfortable beginning. So we don't introduce any language to them or any words. Mm. Person writes out what happened. If we are, then take that statement and properly analyze it in a scientific method, meaning we expect the same results, putting in the same data repeatedly, the investigator can now know this person did it, when he did it, how he did it, why he did it. So now a lengthy investigation has been shortened greatly. An A to Z is this, is the person is then interviewed based on their own words from that analysis. It's called analytical interviewing. No new language is introduced. The subject is not threatened at all. The subject is not interrupted. He is allowed to speak freely about what happened. When he reaches a point where he is caught by his own words, he often will admit what he did. Mm. When he admits what he has done, the investigator then takes the analysis, hands it to him, and says, review this for me. And there's often this type of unity between the investigator and the now suspect, where the suspect shares, oh, your analysis was correct here. Yeah, you're right. I did hide the gun there, and they're able to go mm-hmm. through it. That investigator is now filled with resolve and confidence that he takes into other investigations. Mm-hmm. So it is fantastic traction for their careers. It's a strength for truth, and it becomes a lesson like no other.
The expression, giving someone enough rope to hang themselves, comes to mind.
That would be a good way of using it. They made their own rope with their own words. We didn't hand it to them in that sense. Mm. So it's legally sound.
Right. And obviously the police have the benefit of being able to put someone in that position and not force them to be questioned, but request them to do that. But certain cases that have been high profile in the media, we don't always get that. We don't always get the luxury to be able to put a subject in an interview type situation to write out their version of events. We go by snippets that have come out in the media, and we are going to come on to a case shortly. Can you recall what the first case you looked at was?
The first case that I worked for someone else, I've had success on my own, but the first case that I actually worked for someone else came after an instruction where there had been a theft, and local police had investigated the theft, but what they determined was that the company had too many employees that could have done it. Mm-hmm. And therefore, they just closed it as unsolved. And the company had sent employees for training. And they asked if I could review their work. And then they eventually asked, could you take over for us? So I had all the employees write out what they did during their shift. I came back and said, here's the one that stole it. Here's when he stole it. Here's how he stole it. They asked if I would conduct the interview. I did, and he confessed.
Right. Very good. And have you got a rough figure as to how many cases you've looked at?
Hundreds. It would be hard to tell, right, because it's most cases, I should say, at this point in my life, most cases I'm just assisting investigators. Mm-hmm. They're the ones doing the work. They're the ones that, and many of them are so good that they'll send me their analysis. That's an important thing. A good analyst never stands on his or her own footing. We always ask someone to check our work, always a second set of eyes, at least. Mm-hmm. And so we have many now in training that other law enforcement is asking them for help now because they're so good at it. Right. They're driven for justice.
And is your work ever used in court or by other professionals?
Well, it's used in court routinely. Statement analysis, like the polygraph, is not admissible as evidence. What happens is during even a cross-examination, the trained investigator is using statement analysis as he goes into testimony. So for instance, an example of this is a man who was accused of murder, took the stand in his own defense. And this is an example of how a prosecutor used the statement analysis to a successful conclusion. The man had been accused of killing a 13-year-old little girl out in the woods. He had claimed that he was alone in the woods. And when he took the stand in his own defense, the prosecutor asked, well, tell us what happened and what happened next. Those are the two most powerful questions that we have. What happened? What happened next? Mm-hmm. It allows them to choose whatever they want to choose. And this is an important point. The average person has a vocabulary of about 20,000 words. When you ask someone what happened, They must go into that vocabulary, decide what words to use out of the 20,000, where to order them, what verb tenses to use, what pronouns to use, where to place each word next to each other to communicate in less than a microsecond of time. That is a process that, when disrupted by deception, we catch. This man said he was alone. I was sitting down admiring the deciduous trees when we were losing daylight, so I got up, and the prosecutor said, "Excuse me, you said we were losing daylight?" The pronoun "we" is instinctive and intuitive. It meant he was not alone. The defense called for a recess. The next day they came back and attempted to explain away why the word "we" should mean "I." The jury didn't buy it, and he was convicted.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And do you purely look at written statements, or do you listen to audio, or do you watch video?
All of the above.
All of the above.
Yeah. The training begins with only written statements, and that's really the most effective means of doing this. But what happens is, very naturally, it's called statement analysis, moves to a form of discourse analysis when someone becomes better and better over time. Their listening skills improve, and they're able to analyze as they're speaking.
Hmm. Okay, and I've got a list here of some areas that perhaps can indicate deception. Do you want to mention some of it, Peter, before we analyze the interview that we're going to look at?
Sure.
So hesitation?
Well, we look at a disruption. Now, some people naturally will hesitate as they speak, so we look for a pattern. If someone is suddenly hesitating, we want to know why. So we call this a sensitivity indicator, meaning, for example, if I ask you a question and you answer the question with a question, you're buying yourself some time. I know this is an important question. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're being deceptive, but you've sure caught my attention.
Right, okay. And searching for the right words?
Well, thoughtful people can do that, but when they are under a certain context, like in a missing child case, we want to know what is the relationship between the missing child and the subject speaking. If it is a very close relationship, we generally don't see someone pausing or searching just for the right words. They don't care. Mm. All they care about is the missing child.
Mm-hmm. And diverting, avoiding questions?
Common form of deception.
All right. What about unnecessary expansion on certain subjects, like using woolly jargon and that kind of thing? Can that be a form of deception?
Yes. As a matter of fact, it's one of the most important things we look at. When someone uses an unnecessary word, unnecessary phrase, unnecessary detail, we deem it as doubly important.
Right.
I'll give you a good example of that. When I go to the store, in order for me to go to a store, I have to leave where I am at. So someone will say, "I went to the store." The pronoun "I" went past tense, and the store is where they went. It is very likely, statistically, to be reliable. But if someone says, "I left my house and went to the store," it's unnecessary to tell us that they left the house, because you can't get to the store unless you leave. Mm. So we know something happened at the house that you're not telling me. 70% likelihood that it has to do with time or rushing or couldn't find my keys, something like that. But 30% of the time, it's critically withheld information.
Right. And what about distancing language, where you try and refer to a group rather than yourself?
Yeah, there's a couple different forms of distancing language, and we look at distancing language and flag it as such. I went Christmas shopping with Heather. I and Heather couldn't be any further apart in the sentence than I just made it. What caused the distancing? Did we have an argument? Did I not want to go shopping? I could have said, "Heather and I went Christmas shopping," mm-hmm. but I didn't. So "I went Christmas shopping with Heather" puts me and Heather far apart. Sometimes the distance is nothing more than geographical. Sometimes it is strongly psychological. In cases where we expect very closeness, like if an assault case, a missing person case, an assault case is very personal. The language should reflect that. when someone has something happen to them where their body space was invaded and they were harmed, there's a hormonal response that's always going to show itself in the language. Mm-hmm. So when someone says that they were assaulted and there's distancing language, we look for deception.
Okay. And what about the use of the word would? I would have done instead of I did do.
Sure. It's one of the things that deceptive people use, and here's why. I said before that the average person has 20,000 words in their vocabulary. A more intelligent person might have 25, even 30,000 words. And when you ask them what happened, they must go into their memory. And when experiential memory speaks, it is very smooth and it goes in chronological order. A lie will disrupt that, and that causes internal stress. So people say, well, you know, sociopaths don't feel stressed when they're lying. That's not true. They feel very stressed when they're lying because they don't want to be caught. So to disrupt that process is very stressful, and those that are really good at lying will use a substitute of words. So one of the things they'll do, instead of saying, I did not use performance-enhancing drugs, they say, I never used performance-enhancing drugs. I would never. And what they're doing is they're actually distancing themselves from an actual denial. We saw this many years ago in Lance Armstrong, where he repeatedly used the word would never or never. In all the years that I watched his interviews, all the transcripts that I've seen, not once did he say, I didn't use performance-enhancing drugs. He avoided it.
And what about qualifying words, which change or weaken a statement? Tell us about that.
Sure. It can be used appropriately, it can be used inappropriately. If I said to you, I locked my keys in the car, you can be confident that I know where my keys are, they're locked in the car. If I said to you, I think I locked my keys in the car, that's called a weak assertion because I'm not certain if they're there. I did not shoot that man is very different from saying, I don't think I shot the man.
Yeah. Okay. And what about using the past tense about a recently missing person?
This is critical. In all missing person cases, we look at the use of past tense. And Richard, when it comes to a missing child and a close relative, meaning the biological father or the mother, there is such a natural denial, even stronger in women than men, that we have cases where a child has gone missing, the child has been found deceased, and the mother refuses to reference her child in the past tense. She just cannot accept it. So if a mother in particular, or a father, but especially a mother with the increased intensity of the bond, references her child in the past tense, we want to know something. We want to know why she thinks or believes the child is deceased. Because at times, even if the police tell them, we believe your child is dead, a mother will not accept that. Mm-hmm. So when a mother of a missing child speaks of the child in the past tense early on before the processing has taken place, she's giving us a strong indication that she may know more than she's saying.
All right. And what about refusing a polygraph test? Can you read anything into that or not?
Yes. John Walsh has become famous, unfortunately, for the tragedy that happened in his life here in America. And he advises people very publicly. And what I mean by very publicly is not just through his own website, but through every television appearance he does regarding missing children, is he says to the parents, take a polygraph immediately so the police can do their work and find your child. When someone refuses to take a polygraph, they have a reason to refuse it. And that's a great concern.
Right. Okay. And tell us about the ratio of how much time people spend when they're telling a story at the beginning and the middle of it and an end and what that might reveal.
Sure. We actually measure the content of someone's account. And a truthful account will generally be broken down into three parts. If your child went missing, and I were to ask you questions about it, the most important thing to you is your child missing. That's what you're going to talk about. And so the bulk of your words are going to be focused on your child and what happened. You might introduce it saying, I went to dinner, and that's a short introduction, and then you talk about your child, and then afterwards you called 911, or you called police, or you called for assistance. But the bulk of your account is going to be found right in the middle. What happened to your child is the most important thing to you. Deceptive people who have guilty knowledge of what happened to their child don't want to talk about it because it causes internal stress. So they talk a great deal of time in what happened beforehand. That's where they focus their details. Whereas any parent without guilty knowledge, any innocent parent, is going to focus upon the child. Now, when I say innocent, I mean a de facto innocence, not a judicial innocence. People are innocent until proven guilty in a court of law in the United States. What I mean by innocent is the de facto or in fact innocence. They have no guilty knowledge of what happened to their missing child. Mm-hmm. That type of innocence. So right. It's important
yeah.
to...
Yes, yeah, I understand that. Now, you run a blog, Peter, where a lot of this statement analysis subject is discussed. Can you put everything on there, all of your professional cases, or are you limited as to what you can write on the blog?
Yeah, the blog is only cases that I'm not professionally involved in. So the most fascinating cases never reach the blog. The blog is also a tool of advertising for my business. The blog catches the attention of investigators and who say, oh, you know, I'd like to study that more in depth. Most of them have had some training in their academies. Some were privileged to go on to the FBI's National Academy, where they learned deception detection. But what I produce on the blog is short summaries, not in-depth analysis. It would take far too long to explain some of the things there. Mm-hmm. On the case of missing Madeleine McCann, I didn't cover it a great deal. It fascinated me, but I didn't cover a great deal because it seemed that it was saturated with coverage. Mm-hmm. And when something becomes that heavily covered, I generally move on to something else. And so I put a general analysis on the blog about it, but really in the interview, there's much more there than... Much more right. in the content of the analysis mm-hmm. than is on the blog.
So this was an interview that the McCanns did in 2011, and I think it was on Australian television. And you did an analysis of that interview, of what they said in that interview, of their statements. So you transcribed the interview first, and then you've put your analysis on the blog. So why did you choose that particular one? Was there any reason, or was it just the first one you came across? What was there any reason why you chose that one? Because they've done a lot of interviews.
Yeah, this was one that someone sent the transcripts to me.
Right.
Transcription services is expensive and it's time consuming. I can't do that. I can't go that. So there are people that are associated with the blog who will send trusted transcribed interviews to me. And I have to make a decision at any given time. What do I have enough time to go into? Mm-hmm. I also have to weigh in is that if I get involved with this and law enforcement sees it and contacts me, I've got to delete it and try to assist them.
Sorry, you have to delete that. Why would you have to delete it? You mean on that case if they get in touch with you?
On any given case, if law enforcement requests that it not be there, that it could hinder the investigation, I take it down.
Oh, I see. So let's say that people who were investigating the Madeleine case weren't happy with that and asked you to take it down, right? I see.
Yeah. Or if this has happened before too, is where a police department will say, I saw your analysis, it's really good. Could you help me on this case? I delete it because I can't comment on something that's going to be adjudicated.
Right.
I don't ever want to interfere with justice. Justice comes before anything else.
Right. And before we do some analysis on this interview, because you've reappraised it, is that right to say that this 2011 interview, you've done more detailed analysis on it? Is that?
Yes. My conclusion hasn't changed. My general conclusion hasn't changed. But what I've done is more intense analysis, and there's several reasons for that. One of the reasons is your interest. Your interest is a professional interest here that is deeper than just an average person reading an article. You'd like to know the truth and in detail. Mm-hmm. And so I can give you some of the details. But there's also something else, and this really applies to so much else in life as well, is when we do analysis of a case and we review the analysis later on, we generally will pick up a little bit here, a little bit there that we may have missed or didn't focus upon. when we reanalyze something from what we call disparate eyes, from a mind that has moved on to other things, it is called the 40% rule. The same content may yield 40% more information. Mm-hmm. And it's quite practical in the sense that your mind goes on a scent. You pick up a scent and you follow it. And once you follow it to completion, you've got a good portrait. When you look at it again, maybe a month later, you don't have that same scent. Mm-hmm. And you say, oh, you know, I need to focus a little more on something else here now. And that yields more and more content. Then you can take it and hand it to another trained analyst who now brings in more information. And so although it doesn't change the conclusion, it enhances the analysis itself. Mm-hmm. We're literally entering into the perception of reality from the speaker.
Before you tell us your analysis on this interview, just want to mention the legal aspects of this. This is opinion. Yeah, there's no statement of innocence or guilt. Is that just tell us what an analysis is in those terms?
Yeah, this is we call it presuppositional thinking. We go into a statement presupposing an opinion. Now, when someone speaks publicly, there is an expectation that is presupposed. You're either going to believe me or you're not. And the public, we have a right to say, I believe what they're telling me. I don't believe what they're telling me. It is just my opinion. If I say I believe someone or I don't believe someone, as a statement analyst, it's my opinion and here's why I have this opinion. So I'm able to explain why. Now, this is not, it sounds like a moral exercise. It's not. When someone speaks, we presuppose that everything they're telling us is the truth. We actually go into the analysis believing everything they said, unless they talk us out of it. If they talk us out of it, not only are we able to pick up that they are deceiving us, but the words that they chose in deceiving us can often reveal what happened. Mm-hmm. And that's what I believe is the case we're going to look at.
But because the analysis is your opinion, you've not had any legal issues from subjects that you've done analysis on in the past, just to ask that question.
Well, I've had some complaints. Representative Anthony Weiner from New York was upset several years ago about my analysis. He had been sending sexual pictures to people from his phone, and he claimed that it wasn't him doing it. Oh. And so I had received a complaint from them, and I said, number one, it's my opinion. Number two, I'll take it down when he tells the truth. Right. And since then, it's
okay.
Yeah,
and you're confident because you obviously understand why I'm asking that question,
yeah.
Don't you? Yeah, and but you're confident that because it's opinion, it's absolutely fine to say, and there's no ramifications.
Yeah, unless someone has been convicted in a court of law, they are judicially innocent, and we have an opinion whether we believe that's accurate or not. Mm-hmm. However, because of what I do for a living, my opinion has consequences. So if I am able to go through an entire interview like the McCanns gave and make a conclusion, it's going to impact my ability to provide for my family. So anyone can have an opinion that's perfectly appropriate. It's legal to have an opinion. If I have an opinion, I can say anywhere between 10% to 100% certainty of my opinion. There's something on the line there for me. If I am wrong, law enforcement is not likely to hire me to work for them.
Right.
But first, for 4 years, Kate and Jerry McCann have lived a never-ending ordeal, and they still don't know when or if it'll ever end. It began on a family holiday in Portugal when Madeleine, their four-year-old daughter, simply vanished. She hasn't been seen since. Tonight, the mystery deepens. You're about to see home video never shown before and learn the vital clue Madeleine left behind. Here's Ronnie Sadler.
Okay, spin around, darling. Right round. Oh, yes, I can see your wings.
It's a big smile.
Oh, yes. One more, big smile. That's pretty.
She was an incredibly beautiful baby, actually.
You sound like the most biased parents on the planet now, but she was just really compact and just a really kind of nice, round, perfect head and, you know, and then she opened her mouth and the whole world knew she was with us.
This would not be considered a blatant past tense use of the verb was. Here she says, she was incredibly beautiful baby, actually. One could argue that she, at age three, she's no longer a baby, and that they are referring to a period of when she was born, and that would be an appropriate use of the past tense. So I don't assign to this a red flag because of the context. It does concern me at this point, it's just a little bit of alarm now, that in an interview of a missing child, they're talking about her in the past tense. I expect some form of follow-up that will be in the present tense. A single slip into past tense is an indicator of belief or knowledge that the child is deceased. And that's what's concerning about that. But there are also some other things that are there that aren't any major blaring red flags, but as they build point after point, they become concerning. One of the things is this. Parents of missing children who show guilty knowledge of what happened to the child will often find a subtle way of insulting the child, insulting the victim, blaming the victim, disparaging the victim. When someone is missing, like or when a child is deceased, we call it the angelic view. The child is elevated beyond any normal child. They just, everything is wonderful. And we hear the subtle disparagement in guilty parents. Casey Anthony actually called her little daughter a name, a derogatory name. In shaken baby syndrome cases, the baby wouldn't stop crying as if it was the baby's fault. The baby wouldn't take her formula as if the baby was at fault. And what that is, in guilty statements, within human nature, there is some drive to justify what happened, to clear oneself. So I don't like the several things about this. I don't like a past tense reference without following up present tense. It continued there. And we have a praising of the baby that I do like. And then when she opened her mouth, the whole world knew she was with us, is a subtle way of saying that she was really loud. I'm not sure that sounds like praise. I have six children. I have two grandchildren. And I listen to the words of parents regularly. And given the setting of an interview where the child is missing, it's not something I expected to hear. Now, it's not a point I'm going to hang my hat on, but I've been called to the attention now that maybe Madeleine was a little bit loud for them. It's a really strange place to be giving even a small complaint.
She had McCann level volume, there's no doubt about that.
Yay! Well done. Okay, let's sing another one.
I always wanted to be a mother. I don't know, maybe that stemmed from being an only child and sort of, you know, wanting that feeling of family.
Madeleine was the daughter Kate and Jerry McCann always wanted. For years, Kate struggled to fall pregnant, so when Madeleine came along, they felt blessed. They loved to photograph her, and she loved being photographed. This is the last picture of Madeleine, taken 7 hours before she disappeared.
There's a photo of her that afternoon that was taken at 2:29, I think, because we've got it on the digital camera. And she was just sitting by the pool with myself, and we've both got our feet just paddling, and she's so happy.
I'm concerned, again lightly, but it is increasing, and here's why. They're speaking in terms of nostalgia. This is what we do when a child is not coming back. They are waxing nostalgic about a child that's missing. And this is going to become right now a very minor point is going to become a major red flag for deception. If you were able to put yourself into their shoes, which is what we always do, put yourself in the shoes, what would you be like? What would you be like if your child was missing? And this is what is terribly missing from the interview. Statement analysis deals with what one tells us. It also deals with what one doesn't tell us. When parents of missing children have no involvement or no guilty knowledge of what happened to the child, their focus is on what the child is experiencing now. Does she have her favorite blankie? Does she have her teddy bear? Is someone looking at her warm smile? Are they kissing her? Is she scared at night? They are consumed by these thoughts. These people are speaking as if they have already processed something, which is her death.
It's been 1,543 days since Madeleine McCann vanished. To keep Madeleine's case alive, this private couple has revealed more of themselves than ever before. Kate and Jerry are both doctors. They married in 1998, and in 2001, after 3 years of failing to conceive naturally, they began IVF. 18 months later, on the eve of another hospital appointment, Kate did a home pregnancy test.
A little line appeared on the test. You know, I'm a doctor and it says on the box any kind of line is a positive, but I was like, oh, I'm not sure, not sure. But there's that faint kind of...
Showed it to me and I'm like, it's definitely.
It's definitely. No question. Yeah. And obviously we had a scan and there's a little beating heart and that was our little Madeleine, you know, so...
Who's that present for?
That's for Andrea.
Are we going to post it today?
No.
We are.
There's a letter.
Uh-huh. Who says uh-huh? Uh-huh. Say yes, Daddy.
Yes, Daddy.
Okay.
And then, in May 2003, three became five.
When she first saw the twins, she was just ecstatic. Absolutely ecstatic.
Oh, we took a very big toilet.
Blessed really at that time.
You say the family felt really complete.
Mm. Yeah, we did feel incredibly lucky.
In late April 2007, the McCanns decided to travel to Portugal for a family holiday. In the pink pants climbing the stairs to the plane is Madeleine. It was the McCann's first overseas holiday as a family, and they went with three other couples.
Cheer up, Jerry, we're on holiday.
It's a small resort. It was out of season, end of April, beginning of May, and it was incredibly quiet. We felt very relaxed there, very relaxed.
A couple of things about that is we like to hear people speak for themselves how they felt, not for we. Then we look at anything that's repeated. So we have the word relaxed, repeated. We have the word very repeated. So very relaxed, and not for himself, Jerry, but for both of them speaking. Okay. So if they're speaking together, that's appropriate. They're now speaking, he's now speaking of their emotion together, and that's not always so usual. And they are telling us how very relaxed they are. This is narrative storytelling. This is setting a scenario. We call it the normal factor. If you take a seven-year-old child and you say to the child, once upon a time, on a day that was just like every other day, the child will sit up knowing that what's about to happen was unlike any other day. Mm-hmm. That's called the normal factor. If someone says, I'm a normal man, what they're saying to you is either they themselves or someone else has said, you're not normal. It's unnecessary. Well, here, what we call this as a need to persuade that this was a normal day is telling us he knows it's anything but. Mm. That's storytelling. That's when those in law enforcement will say, I feel like they're storytelling. They're actually narrative building. They're bringing your emotions into an account. Instead of saying, my daughter's missing. I don't know what she's experiencing. I don't know who she's looking at. I don't know if they're giving her her medicine. With that urgency, they're not only did they wax nostalgic, but now they're allowing you to enter into their emotions, and I want you to make sure that you understand my emotions were very relaxed. So at some point you say, wow, you sure seem to need to convince me that it was a normal, relaxing day. Why do you have to convince me of that?
In the evening, the children were put to bed by 7:30, before the adults had dinner together down at the pool. From where they ate, Kate and Jerry could see the back of their apartment and left the door unlocked.
If you measure it directly from the back of the apartment, it's a straight line to where we're dining. It's only 50 metres.
50 metres.
That's a direct line.
49.4 on Google if you want to be really specific.
Okay, now one would say in defence of them is that, hey, they've been accused of neglect. And they're defending themselves so much to the point that Kate went online and Googled it and found out exactly the distance that it was away. There's a problem with that, however. She's missing. I expect them to talk about not defense of themselves, but concern for her right now, at this moment of the interview. It's not there. Statement analysis deals with what one says and what one doesn't say. Now we're being given a lot of detail about the distance. Before, I was given a lot of detail about what Madeleine was like. I've not heard yet a single detail about what Madeleine's experiencing in the hands of strangers.
But the proximity was very close.
This is insightful because, first of all, the word but will refute what just preceded it or minimize what preceded it. But this is insightful. I simply ask a listener to answer this question for me. Who are they most concerned about? Are they most concerned about Madeleine or about themselves? How can they not be concerned about Madeleine? How could they even care? They should be really accusing themselves of neglect. The fact that they don't accuse themselves of neglect but are justifying themselves tells you something else. Not only do we not have concern for Madeleine, we have concern for self. Why would you be concerned for self?